Thank you very much. thank you for coming to this meeting, and I'm very grateful to my friend and colleague Boaz Modai. It's now almost 30 years since I was in between missions. I was head of mission in Beirut, and then I was sent to Hong Kong to try and open up relations with China, and in between I had respite of a few months, which I asked to do some work for the diplomatic school. And one of the outstanding, by measure and by brain, was Boaz Modai. And we had many hours together, and I knew that one day we'll meet again, and he'll make it. 3 years ago, it so happened that I was recalled from the shadows to do something for the for an effort, combined effort of the Jewish world and the foreign ministry regarding the memory of the Holocaust and the heirless property of the Jews killed in the Holocaust, in a conference in Prague, and Boaz became my chief assistant. And then I was glad to hear that he was sent here, and I'm sure that life in Ireland has changed ever since.
For me, certainly.
Now, it so happened that I was lucky enough to start my public service at the age of 17 when I finished high school, because I was kicked out from preschool. And I went to the army at a very early age, and then served on a kibbutz for a while, and then went to study Islamics, because I knew from a very early age that we have to find ourselves a safe place in the area, to know our neighbors, to live with them, and to follow the maxim which was coined by the father of Zionism, Theodor Herzl, who in 1897 convened about 100 Jewish leaders from Europe to the first Zionist Congress in Basel. And one of the Basel program included very important principles. One of them was a national home for the Jews in Palestine. And the second one, that national home should act according to the international law. It was understood, very well understood by Herzl, who was a man of the world, that we cannot be a standalone phenomenon. We have to be part of the family of nations. We have to abide by international rules. We have to accept international norms, part of which we, in our own tradition, have established many, many years ago. For instance, the principle of the liberty of the human being, the liberty of thinking, the liberty of exchanging views, as we celebrate every year in Passover, which we recite every year in a very important tradition, which we, everyone, secular or religious, holds until this day. And looking back at what Herzl did then, when Herzl did these things, there was no Palestine. It was part of what was called Greater Syria, with various provinces in the southwestern part of the Ottoman Empire. And I'm going to have a look at it, a very brief look, what happened to the Ottoman Empire since 1914. And after all, it's not much time, it's a bit over. It's 100 years in history. The oldest town in recorded history is Jericho, 7,000 years. Written recorded history is 5,000-6,000 years. Human history is 150,000 years. It's but a fraction. So 100 years is but a second. But look what happened in these 100 years. We had two world wars. We had the War of Independence of Ireland. We had the War of Independence of Israel. The world has changed. Four empires were broken to pieces. And we live in a different world altogether. And the changes have not yet ended. We are in a constant process of changes, and as such we have to regard, we must see our world, because that's the situation which is. Now look at Europe. There was the Austro-Hungarian Empire, which after the First World War, out of that empire came Yugoslavia. Yugoslavia was then, since then, united, reunited and fragmented twice. Now out of one Yugoslavia you have got seven. Of one Czechoslovakia, you had two, then you had one, and now you have two again. Etc., etc., etc. It's not yet over. It's not yet over. Borders have changed, populations have moved. All these are results of the crumbling of great empires. Now let's go east to the Ottoman Empire, which has ruled the area for almost 500 years, from the, let's say, 14th century unto the 20th century. Could I have the first map you see? It's very clear. After all the changes which happened with the slow retreat of the Ottoman Empire from Europe, don't forget that in 1683 the Ottomans came as far as Vienna. When we eat a croissant for our breakfast, the croissant is a symbol of the guild of bakers who celebrated the retreat of the Ottomans from Vienna to resemble the crescent. And this is, since then, the Turks have slowly retreated back to the mainland, keeping only this part of Adrianople, Edirne, which is 20,000 square kilometers in Europe. All the rest, which used to belong to them, the Balkan, which they have conquered since 1389, when they won the Battle of Kosovo, and all the other 1526, when they the Battle of Mohacs in Hungary, all this they lost already. But this they still kept. This is the whole of Anatolia, the whole of what they call Turkish Arabia, which is Iraq, Hijaz, and of course these parts of Greater Syria. This was the Ottoman Empire in 1914. Egypt, they have lost control of to the British, who, because of their control of the Suez Canal, took over the slowly Egypt, first through a resident and through a consul general, actually ruling Egypt indirectly, though there were some kings there, kings who were actually descendants of an Albanian tobacco merchant by the name of Muhammad Ali, who bought the residence in Egypt for a lot of money so he can divide the taxes between himself and the Ottoman Empire. Anyway, so this is what we have in 1914. Could I have the second map, please? Now, this is what happened after the First World War. There was a division of the southern part of the empire between France and Britain. And this is how what I call the tailored states came about. States which were tailored by the imperial powers of the time, according to their needs and according to what could be done in these territories. One is Iraq, which was composed of three vilayets, three provinces, the northern one, the central one, the Sunni, and the northern the Kurdish, the central the Sunni, and the southern the Shiite. And then was Syria, which was composed of four provinces which were related to the main four cities and the Alawite area. Lebanon, which was an agglomeration of 17 communities held together by its weakness. And then there was Palestine, which until 22 included Eastern Palestine and Western Palestine. Western Palestine and Eastern Palestine. And then the Saudis, the Saudi family, who had ruled the center of the Saudi of the Arab Peninsula in 25, took over the Hijaz, and the English remained with the Hashemite family, which was ruling Hijaz before, and then they had to place them somewhere, so they placed Faisal in Baghdad, and Abdallah in Amman, and someone they left here, the sheriff, not so important. That's the situation as it was. And these tailored states could hold water for 50, 60 years. A tailored state can hold water as long as the forces from outside are strong enough to keep it, and as long as the forces from the inside are not strong enough to dismember it. Now, in Iraq, you had all these turmoils. You had the first revolution in July of 58, when the Hashemite family was kicked out. In Jordan, you had all these upheavals, but they're still holding water. And in Syria, what you have, very soon Syria will not exist as one united tailored state. The Kurdish part here will go to be united somehow with the Kurdish minority of Iraq. The other white part will be separated. Lebanon will be kept as it is because it's too weak to be independent, and its weakness keeps it together. And the question of Palestine will have to wait a bit. We'll speak about it later. About the Arab Peninsula, I mean, there's no question about it. Saudi Arabia is strong enough to keep it. Let us not forget that the Saudi family, until 1938, got £5,000 a year from the British Crown to maintain its rule. Until they found oil, they couldn't do anything. Turkey, what the Turks did, although they were beaten badly in the First World War, they had this genius, Mustafa Kemal, whose name became to be Atatürk, the father of the Turks. He reunited Turkey. He took all these parts, and under the Greeks had some futile attempts to reconquer parts of the former Greek Anatolia. He repelled them and reunited Turkey, secularized it, Latinized the alphabet, and brought Turkey to a path of progress on which it is still now, despite the shakes and the trembling of the recent years. Could I have the third man? Here I just wanted to illustrate what I've shown before, the European scene, Austria, Yugoslavia, and Czechoslovakia, the changes, and so on. You can go further. Please go ahead. Yeah, that's the plastic illustration of what I've shown before. Please go ahead. Please go ahead. Okay, now we come to Palestine. In Britain, there were two political... the British politics as such in 1917 recognized the Jewish right for a national home in Palestine. And then came Churchill, the secretary of the colonies in 1922, and said, okay, Eastern Palestine for the Arabs, Western Palestine for the Jews. He separated them and put Abdallah here first as a governor under the High Commissioner in Jerusalem, but then as an independent emir. And that's the way it was supposed to continue. And as far as the Palestinians are concerned, there were supposed to be negotiations which dragged on for a while. At the same time, there was a beginning of a revival of a Palestinian movement, which began actually in practical terms, I would say, in 1912, 1915, 1920. But it was, to a great extent, a reaction, first of all, to what happened in the whole Arab world, and to what happened with the Jewish immigration to Palestine, because the Arabs of Palestine felt themselves threatened by the Jewish immigration into Palestine. Now, since 1920 until 1947, there were ongoing negotiations at various levels between Jews and Arabs, sometimes mediated by the British, the Peace Commission, sometimes mediated directly or done directly between Arab leaders and Jewish leaders, Ben-Gurion and others. I don't want to go into it. It's boring, too many footnotes. Until the matter came to the UN in 1947, and there was a petition, plan of partition. The plan of partition was adopted by the Jews, rejected by the Arabs. Then you had the war, and you can go to the next matter. This was the petition, this is Churchill, 22, that's Western Palestine, please, you can go ahead. This was the plan of partition. The blue for the Jews, the brown for the Arabs. This was accepted by the Jews in 47. I was a child of 11 years at that time. I remember the Jews dancing in the streets of Haifa. No one can take away memories, genuine memories of a child of 11 when he sees grown-up people dancing in the streets. And then you had the declaration of the Arab League. The Arab League came into being in 1945. Previously, in 1937, the Arab states, who were then fledgling states with little amount of independence, the Arab leadership of Palestine decided to hand over their case to the Arab states. And then they decided, once the Arab League was established, to hand over to them the resolution, and the unanimous resolution of the Arab League under the leadership of Hosni Mubarak was to invade Palestine, and the rest of the history, come May 15, 1948, and the Arab invasion started. We say seven armies, it was actually five armies, and the Jews were then 600,000 Jews, but there were lots of voices, but one writer, because they were united. And the Arabs were not united, they were disunited, there were lots of problems with them, they didn't have the real united command, and the result of that was, please, this was the end of the War of Independence in 48, and with the Armistice Agreement of 48, 49, which should be the prolegomena to peace. And then peace negotiations started, first in Lausanne and then in other places, and they ended nowhere. And they ended nowhere until we came to the situation of 67, and I don't want to go into it. You can go one more ahead. It ended up that you have one Palestine here, and one Israel here. And the situation around us is described more or less. Jordan is still holding water, though it's very difficult. Egypt, we have seen all these turmoils. Over the years, there were many attempts to reach peace agreements with the neighboring countries. With Egypt, we had a peace agreement in 79, finalized in 82, and then finalized again in 89, when I was the one who signed the last agreement regarding Taba here. And then we had the agreement of 94 with Jordan, which still holds water. And we were supposed to discuss with Syria, it never materialized. And you had then Oslo, you had Camp David, you had all these things. I was in Camp David in the year 2000, and I can tell you, the offer which Barak gave to Arafat to give him 95% of the, as the basis of negotiation for the establishment of a Palestinian state, was a good offer to start with. It was rejected, and the rest is again history. Please, go ahead. Now, this is as much as I want to say about Israel in a nutshell. About the Kurds, the only nation, the Palestinians have a national expression. The Jordanians have a national expression. The Iraqis have one, the Syrians have one, the Lebanese have one. The only national entity, or national, I would say, personality, if you can say it this way, that doesn't have a representation in the Middle East are the Kurds. 35 million of them, 15 million in Turkey, 8 million in Iran, 8 million in Iraq, and about 2 million in Syria. Can you go ahead, please? The maximum they have achieved until now is an autonomous area in the north of Iraq, which is not only autonomous, it's semi-independent, because they have oil and they can sell the oil and they have money. You have this area in Syria, with 2 million people, which eventually I think will be somehow federated with the one in Iran. You have this area in Iran which tried to get some kind of independence in 1946 when they formed the Republic of Mahabad, which was then crushed by the Iranians, but they're still there. And then, of course, you have all these people, 15, 18 million in Turkey. Turkey is never going to give it up. They will give them some autonomy, they'll give them some, until a few years, they couldn't use their language, they couldn't teach Turkey, Kurdish. Any Kurdish organization would be illegal and so on. You can put it, this is just, it's not a political drawing. This is just, I would say, to give you a vision how it looks. It's not a map, it's not a political prophecy, it's not a proposal, it's nothing. It's just a reality how these people are divided. And there was only one statesman in the West, whose name was Woodrow Wilson, who said they should get some kind of self-definition. But they never got it, because their side didn't materialize. The Turks didn't want it. The powers that be between the British and the French were not interested, and of course the Turks were not interested. So that's the situation about the Kurds. It's beside the pond, but it is there. It's not going to leave the scene. We are going to hear more of it in the future. And I hope it will not lead to wars. I was very happy to read that in Turkey the situation is somehow better first of all, they have not executed Öcalan, and secondly, they give more autonomy as far as teaching Kurdish is concerned and so forth. I hope this trend will continue. Can you please go ahead? Now, let me go back to the crux of the matter. This is the Temple Mount. The whole of the area of the old city of Jerusalem is less than 1 square kilometer. Less than 1 square kilometer. Out of this, 15% are the Temple Mount. These walls were built by Herod the Great. The Dome of the Rock was built in the 8th century. Al-Aqsa Mosque was built on the foundations of the Byzantine Church, also in the 7th, 8th century by the Umayyads. The Umayyads, who were then ruling the Arab world from Syria, wanted to have a counterweight to Hijaz, this was political, religious, whatever. And the fact remains that but for a short period of 200 years in which this was in the hands of the Crusaders, since 638, this was always in Muslim hands, and that's the way it's going to remain. Because 2 days after the end of the Six-Day War, the keys of the Al-Aqsa, of all this area, were handed over to the Muslim Waqf. They keep the keys until this day. The Israeli police keeps the perimeter, and over 43 years or whatever, only on 3 or 4 occasions the police broke in because there were disturbances, because topographically, if this is the Wailing Wall and here thousands of people converge and stone are being thrown at them from above, the police has to do something to avoid it. But otherwise, the name Al-Aqsa Intifada is a lie, because Al-Aqsa is in Muslim hands, and was in Muslim hands and will remain in Muslim hands. This is an assurance, it will remain so, and it's also buttressed by a religious ruling by the chief rabbinate, which said the Jews are not supposed to pray here. Why? Because nobody knows where the temple was. We know that the temple was here, but perhaps if someone prays here or here, he treads on the place where the holy scripture were in the temple. And this is a sacrilege. So this is why there is a religious ruling forbidding Jews to pray here. Jews can come and visit here. When they come at certain hours, which are dictated by the Waqf, the Muslim authority. The Jordanians have a say here. They pay part of the salaries of the guards here and of the administration, but Al-Aqsa is in Muslim hands. Now, Jerusalem is today a city of 750,000 people. 250,000, 260,000 of them are Arabs. over 500,000 Jews. There will be no solution to the problem of the Middle East until there is a settlement for the problem of Jerusalem. I am convinced of that. Because we have borders, we have security, we have settlements, we have right of return, we have Jerusalem. Jerusalem is the most sensitive one. And we should have to deal with it on the basis that the less sanctity we deal with, the better we are. And there is a very small area, which is less than 1 square mile, where you have all the sanctity of the world in Jerusalem, and this you can administer, you can deal with, you can say, overall sovereignty we leave to God, like the late King Hussein said, sovereignty over holy places is with God. It's true, it's with God. But let someone administer it, because someone has to control. If there is no one who wants to bring a bomb in, be it a Muslim or a Jew, because a bomb on the Temple Mount will be not a world war, but it will be a cataclysmic event. Cataclysmic event. And if you remember what happened over the last 43 years, all the attempts to blow up what this very sensitive powder keg here failed. And we should pray every day 3 times that this happened. And believe you me, the government of Israel is doing whatever it can to avoid any catastrophe here. And it will have to wait. We'll find a settlement for that. We'll find some kind of a settlement. And I think we should understand the Syrian president, the father of the incumbent president, his name was Hafez al-Assad. He died about 10 years ago. He once said, he had a discussion with the Jewish leader of Lebanon, Walid Jumblat, whom he eventually killed, because you know these things. They didn't see eye to eye on a certain matter, and then the Syrians dealt with it in a very harsh way. But this Walid Jumblat said, after he spoke to al-Assad, he said, there's a place for everyone in the Middle East, but there is no place for all the ambitions. And I go back to what Herzl used to say, we have to go by the international law, and we have to abide by international law, we have to abide by agreement, we have to reach honest agreements, honorable agreement, and respect them. And we have reached certain agreements with the Arab countries. We reached a very good, important agreement with the Egyptians back in the 70s and in the 80s. It's not respected always. We are very sorry about it. But we are lucky to have the buffer zone of the Sinai Peninsula between Egypt and us. We reached an agreement with Hussein in 1994. It is respected. And we are lucky that the Jordanian regime is strong enough to keep it. We were on the verge of reaching agreement with the Syrians a few years ago, and I hate to think what would happen if we had reached that agreement and we would have come to this juxtaposition now with the turmoil in Egypt, with Syria. What would happen out of this agreement? Now, I am a veteran of agreements with the Chinese. But the Chinese entered into a discussion with the British in 82 about about Hong Kong. That for 2 years on the question of sovereignty. And until they understood that the Chinese are not going to give up on the question of sovereignty. But then they said, okay, both sides said, we'll put the agreements to the test of time. From 1984 to 1997, no change. Everything remains in place. In 1997, sovereignty will go over to the Chinese for another 50 years to stand the test of time. Altogether, you've got 67 years to put the agreements to test. 67 years is not a long time, but it's more than 3 years, more than 5 years, more than 10 years. We live in an historic area where things have historic roots. Every nation has its historic narrative. And everyone has his problems. If we come to an historic agreement after years of strife and of worship, and of conflicting narratives, we have to put the things to test of time, to go stage by stage, to put them to the test of time, to see what materializes, what assurances we have, and how we can go back. Otherwise, all these agreements will remain, as we say, script on ice in the Sahara. Nothing will remain on them. This is how I regard it from here, and then I want to say something about our own question with the Palestinians, but for this I don't need the map. As you well know, the area of Western Palestine is 26,000 square kilometers. About 6,000 square kilometers are the Palestinian Authority, additional 300 or 400 square kilometers are Gaza, which is now ruled by a separate entity, and about 20,000 Israel. In the area of Israel, we have over a million Arabs, mostly Muslims, who enjoy full rights, who have 10 members in the parliament out of 120. I'm proud to say that 4 months ago, before the elections, a certain lady by the name of Hanin Zoubi, presented a candidacy to the parliament, to the Knesset, and was rejected by the Central Election Committee, which is a political body headed by a Supreme Court justice. And this committee disqualified her, said because she is anti-Israeli and she participated in the flotilla and Mavi Marmara and so on, and she speaks against Israel everywhere, and she undermines the existence of the State of Israel. So there was a special session of the Court of Supreme Court. 9 judges out of 14 were on this session, and unanimously they said that she is eligible to run for parliament because we have the freedom of speech, this is a democratic state, and this is a basic right to express her views. The same day, we had news that in Syria, 400 people were killed because of intercommunal strifes, which were expressed in shootings between the army and certain communities in Hamad. Now, we live in a very wild area. And I'm telling you, as a Jew, as an Israeli, and as a sworn Democrat, that our only right to exist is if we hold these values of being free people, living at liberty, side by side with our neighbors, honoring our agreements with them, and not robbing them. But I don't see any reason if by any stapled agreements, Jews cannot live in the Middle East or even in Palestine, where they've been living for generations. Because don't forget that in 1948, we've taken in about 700,000 Jews from Arab lands who have lived there for generations and who had to leave their places because of the Palestinian Arab war. This is my view, and I'll tell you one thing more about settlement, because I know there's going to come a question about settlement. This is what I'm saying to Israeli extremists. People can live wherever they like as long as they don't rob anyone of his rights. But I'll tell you something more. Suppose I were to inherit tomorrow a flat in the most orthodox quarter of Jerusalem, and this flat belongs to me rightfully. And I've got the title deed, and I've got everything, it's registered, and got an agreement and everything, but I cannot ask my son to live there, because his son, his life there will be unbearable, because he cannot open television on a Saturday, he cannot come by car to his place on Saturday, and so on. I mean, his environment does not tolerate him, so I would advise him, take a flat 500 meters aside, don't live there. Because there is a question between what you are, what is rightful to do and what is feasible to do. So I have no question that Jews have the right to live wherever they want in Palestine or in the Middle East. The question is if they can exercise the right everywhere. And if they cannot exercise the right, and if the exercising the right entails more trouble and more strife, I would wait with it. This is my opinion about these things. Now, let me give you one more. I have a few minutes more, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
as long as there was a Cold War and the Middle East became the testing ground for East and West weapons and political strifes and political contests, the strife in the Middle East was very important because the Soviets used Egypt as a testing ground for the MiGs, and we got the American weaponry and used it, and lesser success, greater success. And I mean, it served our purposes, it served also the purpose of the West, of NATO, it served the purpose of others. And it served its purpose. But these days are over. The days are over. And this is no more the case. And today the question is the question of values. The question is of, there's no question anymore of the existence of Israel. Israel is 8 million people, almost 7 million Jews. Many of the Arabs serve somehow, not in the army, but in some kind of civic services. We have a much fuller participation of the Arab population in the labor force. If you go to Israeli hospitals, sometimes you find that 30 or 40% of the doctors and the nurses are Arabs. And also to quote other professions, in courts and everything, it has a long way to go, but we are not there, but we are on the way. Not to mention of right of vote and so on, and let us not forget the Zionist movement, one of the first international political movement that granted the vote to women in 1897. This was 25 years before the Americans and 75 years before the Swiss. So in that respect, we have a very solid tradition. And today, I was for a while heading a college in the north part of Galilee where 20% of the students were Arabs. 40% of these Arab students were women. They already came to this university, to the college, driving their car. And they would, after graduating, they would have their own profession, and they won't have 9 children, they would have 3 or 4. I mean, this is progress in the being, in the making, and this is part of the society. Nobody asked them to be Zionists, but they are asked, they are part of a democratic, liberal, open society, and they exercise it, and they appreciate it. Now, if you look at the area around us, it is a far cry, because there is this democracy in Turkey, not the one we have in Israel, but there is democracy in Turkey. There is a certain amount of democracy in Egypt. But that's it. That's it. Because if in Syria there was a very nice constitution which was worded by Swiss and French jurists, and it was changed within 12 minutes to allow Bashar al-Assad to become president, although he was not yet 35, this is not constitutional. And not to mention other, not to quote other examples. So we live in a very, very wild environment, and it is very, very difficult to keep, to maintain your own lifestyle and your own values in an area which thinks in entirely different terms. Because I was, I served now for 2 years on that commission which was investigated the flotilla incident of Gaza in May of 10. If you see what happens in Gaza, how the Hamas is ruling the place, how it's collecting taxes from the food that the UN is supplying there for free, how they're coercing the people, how they allow certain factions in the south of Gaza to shoot at Israel, despite the fact that we have evacuated the place in the year 2005, leaving all these places empty. I mean, this is not a way to work on peace, and we have a long way to go, and I hope we shall reach it. I hope we shall reach it together, but we have to be patient, and it is very difficult to gauge or to measure all these things in European standards, because don't forget, Europe is long way, and when you think of it, that Germany and France were fighting for 1,000 years. and now they have joined military units under the same command, they have gone a long way. We are not yet there. One more thing about energy, because this I was asked about that question. Energy is losing its importance in the Middle East. It's still very important for Iran, because for Iran it is 85% of its income. Every dollar increase in the price of a barrel of oil gives $1 billion to Ahmadinejad. And as long as he is financially independent, he can subsidize his people. Because 75% of the Iranian population live in the cities. They get subsidized food and oil to the tune of 67%. And they are no more illiterate. 80% literate or 85% literate. And they're just maintaining this regime by the force of the money. This is the importance of the sanction. And I'm not one who belongs to the crowd who said that whenever Ahmadinejad says something stupid, we should cry Holocaust. Holocaust, there was one, there will never be a Holocaust again. This is why we are there. But come on, there are things which we cannot afford in this world, and we cannot afford someone in the area who says such things and builds such power and is a threat to all the area, and it's a global question, not only our question. And the dependence of the Americans on the Middle Eastern oil is shrinking. Our dependence on exterior oil is shrinking because we have found this fantastic quantities of gas in the Mediterranean, which we share with Cyprus, eventually with Turkey. And we are on the way up, because look what this country, what our country is producing, is almost like the Celtic tiger in better days. So we don't have oil. What we have is what we have between our ears and the dexterity of our people. And let me tell you one more thing. Our late Prime Minister, with whom I used to work for 2 or 3 years, Shamir, had his underground code name was Michael. He was named after Michael Collins. And he mentioned to me once or twice why he chose that name. And it is the spirit of liberty which brings small nations to great achievements. And I think this is a great common denominator between us and you. Thank you very much.